right, so how many of you know what a distraction is? Yeah. All right, so that's one, right? That's a distraction. I read about another one, and I want to share it with you. It's a story that most people probably have never heard. Maybe you have. During World War II, our government recruited some of the most, you can turn the phone off now, some of the most talented men from the world of fine arts, from theater and production and sound and video. These guys were recruited as artists and as actors, and they were men who were recruited with a sole purpose into this unusual military unit in World War I. They were the first multimedia tactical deceptive unit in military history. They were known as the Ghost Army. Those guys designed and used things like blow-up tanks. And here's a picture. These tanks they could just pick up. And they had state-of-the-art sound equipment, probably, you know, the precursors to the 8-track, you know, theatrical and sets and props. And they were all there to fool the Nazi army. And they saved tens of thousands of Allied troops their lives. They were the Trojan horse of the World War II. They staged over 20 battlefield deceptions in 1944 to 1945. They used sonic deception. They used loudspeakers to play the sound of armed forces. And they were making the noises, mimicking the noises that would strike fear in the heart of the enemy. A massive theatrical show, and it was kept classified for 51 years. And that is until 1996. In 1996, it was declassified, and one of the members of the Ghost Army said this. Listen to what he said. Our mission was to distract German Nazis. If we can distract them, we can defeat them. If we can distract them, we can defeat them. Distraction. Distractions are dangerous. Distractions can be deadly, and you know what that is, right? You know what a distraction is. It's the guy driving next to you down West Bypass, and he's texting on his phone, and he's swerving all over the road. Or maybe it's the guy eating his Big Mac and drinking his chocolate shake, you know, look, Mom, no hands kind of thing. And it not only happens on the road, but it happens in your house, and it happens in your bank account, and it happens in your relationships. Distractions. Distractions have a way of robbing you of blessings. Distractions have a way of keeping you from your destiny. Distractions can be deadly. In John 10:10, it says this, the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. He comes to destroy your life, but he doesn't destroy your life at gunpoint. I don't know if you've noticed that. He destroys your life by dysfunction and distraction. That's his motive. That's his motive apparatus. Distractions are deadly. Did I already say that? Distractions are deadly. As a matter of fact, it kills your focus. It kills your peace. It kills your opportunities. It kills your joys. It kills your relationships. It kills your career. It kills what might have been or what could be. There is death by distraction, and the devil uses weapons of mass distraction. So write this one down. Would you write it down? The Latin word for distraction is pulled apart. Some of you word geeks, go ahead and Google that and do a little study, and you'll find yourself over in Europe or in France, and you'll see in ancient times these grotesque, sadistic pictures of how they would torture people and how they would tie their limbs and they would tie them to horses, and the horses would pull them apart. Now, that's pretty grotesque, right? That's really what we're talking about, distraction. Distraction has so many of us pulled apart. We're now officially distracted with the highest volume of content in the history of the world, and you carry it around in your pocket. Or then, of course, you stream Netflix and Hulu and Prime and Apple TV, and you get distracted. You scroll forever trying to find something to watch, and you still can't find it. You're distracted and pulled apart. And by the way, that's why we need today's message. Out of Hebrews chapter 12. Turn in or turn on your Bible to Hebrews chapter 12. Yeah, we're going to talk about Jesus is greater than distractions. And the author of Hebrews in chapter 11, you remember, he walked us down the hall of fame of faith. And he showed us men and women of great faith, not perfect faith, but great faith. And he showed us their distractions. But yet they played the game well. And he reminds us and he reminds the readers in that day that if they could make it, if we could make it, then we can make it. That's what he's saying in Hebrews chapter 11. And when you get to Hebrews chapter 12, let's start there in verse 1. Listen to what he says. He says, therefore, now you gotta stop. And when you see a therefore, you always have to stop and say what? What's it there for? You have to ask the question what it's there for. And what he's putting, the therefore is therefore to show you what came before what you're reading now. What came before? Hebrews chapter 11, the encouraging chapter of all those saints who played the game well. And so he says, therefore, read on, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses. Now, I've read that my whole life, and I've thought, well, okay. And I've heard it preached, and I've perhaps even preached it. And some of you may have this false misconception of what's going on here. I used to picture these grandstands and all these people in the grandstands. And the rest of us, we're down on the playing field. And all of those people that have gone before us, I've even heard people say, maybe this has come out of your mouth. Well, you know, grandma's up there and she's watching down on us. Or, you know, those who have gone before, they're watching down and they're cheering us on. Well, that's just not true. And that's just not biblical. You don't find that in the scripture. And many people will use this passage to try to say, well, you know, they've gone before us and now they're all encouraging us from heaven. Listen, I don't want grandma to see what I do on this earth. I don't know about you, but it's just not biblical. What this is talking about are these in Hebrews 11 and many others who have gone on before. It's not them looking at us. It's us that is to look to them. As an inspiration, as an encouragement that we stay in the race that he has set before us. So we get to look to those who've gone before us and we get to be encouraged by the fact that God led them and provided for them and gave to them strength, even in the midst of great difficulty. So let's go on. Since we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders, notice this, and the sin, underline that, circle that, that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Notice verse 2, and here's your greatest example, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer, or your scripture may say the author and the finisher, or the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame. And he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. So here's what the author is doing. The author is using a race metaphor. And it's not so much how fast you run the race. The goal is to finish. It's about perseverance and endurance. And you're going to need that to successfully follow Jesus Christ. By the way, this is not a power walk or a light jog. It's not an early morning run. This is a marathon that comes with twists and turns and distractions that threaten to derail us. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to give you a few strategies to run and beware of the distractions. And I want to start with verse 1 again. Notice what it says, let us throw off everything that hinders. So if you're a note taker, and by the way, note takers are world changers, if you're a note taker, then write this one down. Lay aside the things that encumber us. There's just so many things that weigh us down. And so they don't have to be bad things. I don't know if you've noticed. He's writing here to Hebrew Christians who were distracted with the fascination of Judaism. That's not bad, but Jesus is greater. And anything we put ahead of Jesus encumbers us. Don't miss that. Anything we put ahead of Jesus will encumber us, distract us, and we have to lay it down or throw it off. You remember the story of Mary and Martha in Luke chapter 10. Jesus showed up at the house, and Mary was worshiping Jesus. You know the story. And Martha's in the kitchen banging pots and pans together. She's doing the dishes. She's cleaning up. And she's not happy. She's not happy with her sister. And so here, Martha goes to Jesus, and Martha says to Jesus, tell her to help me. And listen to what Jesus told her. And I want you to look at this in verse 41. Here's what Jesus said. Martha, Martha. know, that's how the Lord answered. You're worried and upset about many things, or you're distracted by so many things. You're encumbered by so many things. And then again, in verse 42, he says, but few things are needed, or indeed only one. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her. You see, here's Martha, and she's distracted by the good things. Maybe you're distracted by some good things. But you're missing out on the better things. She's missing out on what's better. That's what Mary chose. And I want you to notice, maybe you've read this 1,000 times, but did you notice you have a choice? Mary chose, the Bible says. Mary chose. You can choose to hold on to your comfort and your security and your entertainment and your ambition to make money. You can do that until they become distractions from the better things. So he says, lay aside that which encumbers us. That's a strategy to keep from being distracted. Let me give you another one. It's number two. Lay aside the things that ensnare us. Now, get this. Good things can encumber us, but evil things can ensnare us. And I like what it says in the New King James Version, verse 1, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us. It's quite a word picture there. And by the way, get this. This is not the sin that you committed yesterday and you went to God and you asked forgiveness for that sin. I mean, if you confess your sins, God is faithful and just, the Bible says, to forgive you of your sins and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. And so the sin you committed yesterday that you've already gone to God, or you're planning to do that real soon, and you're getting it right with God, that's not the sin we're talking about here. You're back on the track. You're running this race that's set before you. This is the sin that stops you in your tracks. The word ensnare means you're trapped. You have a willful, deliberate sin that has chained you to the ground. This is the deliberate choice to not trust God. Now listen carefully. All sin will mess you up. I say, man, all sin will mess you up. Someone said it like this, sin will take you farther than you want to go. It will keep you longer than you want to stay, and it will cost you more than you want to pay. But look at verse 1 again. He says, the sin. All sin is going to mess you up, but he's talking about a specific sin that you need to watch out for. The sin, a particular sin, and in context of the scripture, this particular sin is unbelief. Chapter 11, over and over, what did he say? It's by faith. It's by faith. It's by faith. We got Abel. We got Moses. We got Abraham. We've got Sarah. We've got all of these. And it was by faith, by faith, by faith, over and over, because you can't be saved without faith. You can't please God without faith. But write this one down. The opposite of faith is unbelief. Somebody says, well, no, it's fear. No, it's not. It's unbelief. The opposite of faith is unbelief. And the devil, and don't miss this, the devil knows that we do what we believe. And don't miss that. The devil knows that you're going to do and be motivated by what you have as your belief system. The devil knows that. I mean, what you do, what you believe, is going to translate in what you do. And so the devil is keenly aware. The enemy knows very well that you're going to do what you believe. So if he cannot destroy you, and he can't, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, he has no power to destroy you. But what he can do is distract you. And he's going to do that at the point of truth. That's why we have so many false doctrines in our world today. Guess who's sown that seed of false doctrine? It's the devil himself. He's been doing it since the start of time. Jesus said, he is the father of all lies. And so if he can't destroy you, then what he's going to do is distract you, and he's going to hit you at the point of truth. Remember, Jesus called him the father of lies, so he attacks your belief system. He has his own ghost army, and he knows faith motivates a person to obedience. Don't miss that. Faith motivates a person to obedience. And write that one down. Faith motivates a person to obedience. When you have faith, you stay on the track. when your faith is strong and sure. And it's like Hebrews 11:1 says, it is a substance. You are seeing things that are unseen because you're walking by faith and not by sight. And as you walk by faith, listen, you stay on track. And so the enemy knocks us off track by distracting us from the truth. The enemy can't destroy you. Let me say it again. He will distract you. So he sows a seed of distraction. If God really loved you, you wouldn't be going through that tough thing. If God really cares, then listen, if he cares about you, he or she would not have left, or they would not be sick, or they wouldn't have died. You would get that raise or that promotion or that new this or that new that. And you can't believe God. That's what he did to Eve in the garden. Listen, that's what he does to you and me, to get us to believe a false. So doubting God, what's he talking about? Doubting God, trusting God, unbelief. I really believe that it trips more believers than any other sin. Unbelief. Because we simply don't believe God. You say, well, no, I believe in God. I got that. Well, yeah, but then, so why don't we pray more? I mean, I believe in God. And I've got a problem, and so I'm going to try to handle it myself instead of bringing it. If you believe him, he says, I can meet all of your needs in Christ Jesus. Well, that's when we really show that we believe. That's really when we, but the devil's going to come along, and he's going to try to distract you from that. He's going to get you to believe something that is not true. He's come to some of us today, and he said to us, he has said, you know, really, you're just not worth much. And you've believed the lie of the devil. Because the Bible says you've been created in the image of God himself. You have been wonderfully made. You are a created individual that God has formed you in the womb. He's made you with a destiny and a purpose. He's made you with beauty. And yet the devil wants to discount that. And some of us have gone down that road and swallowed that blue pill, you know? Some of us have believed what the devil has told us. And so, if that's true in your life, then what's happened is you've been distracted. And you've gotten off the track. You've stopped running this race that he has given to you because you've believed a lie. So there's another strategy that I want to give you, this strategy, and that is, lay aside the things that entangle us. Notice this in verse 1. And let us run with endurance the race that is, underline this, set before us. Now you got to back up and get this one word. This one word, endurance. This word, endurance and perseverance that we find in Scripture. This word has to do with, listen, man, it's going to get hard. You see, so many believers think, well, you know, I've come to know Christ, so now I'm going to tiptoe through the tulips of life. Everything's going to roll my way. Everything's going to be perfect. And guess what? Again, that's a lie of the devil. Jesus never said that. Jesus said, I came to this world and I had trouble, and you will too. And somebody in this building had any trouble at all? Go ahead. You kind of know what trouble is. You've had people that you love that you've stood at their casket and you've thought, man, Lord, I don't know if I can deal with this. And some of you have you found at the end of your paycheck, there's not enough month, you know? And some of you have been in those places where you've heard things that hurt and things that just almost destroyed you. You've had some trouble in life. There's been some things that didn't roll your way. And so what he's saying is you've got to run this race with endurance in those times that are difficult. You can't be distracted. And then he says this, and by the way, he said this race is set before us. That means to stay in your own lane. How many of you know that God has given to each of us a race? And it's set before us. He's given you a race. He's given you a lane, a task, a purpose. He's given to you a divine destiny. Now, you remember I told you the Latin word for distraction is pulled apart. Well, but you need to get this one. The Latin word for attention. This is going to set somebody down a different path today. This is going to help you. The Latin word for attention is to reach toward. Now, here's why that's important. You see, the more I pay attention to the race he's given me, the more I pay attention to the race that is my race that he's called me to run, to the purpose that he's given me, the less I'm distracted, because now I'm reaching toward God's call in my life. Pay attention. That's what Paul said in Philippians 3:14. Listen to what he said. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. I'm pressing on. Yeah, it's tough. By the way, Paul knew something about difficulties in life, but he's paying attention. Notice, he's reaching toward. That helps him deal with distraction, and it'll help you too. If you reach toward what God has called you to do. That's why he could say in Galatians chapter 2, get this one, he could say, I've been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yeah, not I, he says, but Christ lives in me. The life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loves me and gave himself for me. Because here's the thing. When my focus is right, I'm not drifting out of my lane. I'm not drifting out of my lane. He has set before me a task and priorities. I'm not worrying about anybody else and what they're doing in their lane. I'm not distracted. My focus is on Jesus, and he's greater than my distractions. Somebody say amen. You guys are going to have to help me this morning, or maybe we just need to turn a video on. I don't know. I just need to hear that you're here today. Look at somebody next to you and say, Jesus is greater than my distractions. Yeah, I just needed to hear a voice today. That's awesome. Back in the day, I ran the 120-yard low hurdles. Now, you're saying, well, didn't they have high hurdles? And they absolutely did high hurdles. But now I want you to take a look at me, and I want you to understand, I ran the low hurdles, right? The high hurdles were high. Why'd you run the low? Well, because that's kind of fits my motif. God kind of made me that way. But almost every race, somebody would catch a hurdle with their foot and end up in the wrong lane. Now, here's the deal. You have a lead leg when you hurdle. Your lead leg goes out, and then you have a trail leg that goes over the hurdle. The idea is to bring your rear end as close to the top of that hurdle that you can. And back in the day, I would run those 120 lows. They stopped doing that in the late 70s, I believe. And then they moved them indoors to indoor track meets, and then they made them the 100-yard. I ran that a few times in Oklahoma City at the Myriad in Tulsa and a few other places. Ran indoor, and I love that. They were only 60 yards. That was great. And you'll know why after I explain this just a minute. But inevitably, somebody would catch a hurdle, man, and they would roll that hurdle up, and they would roll themselves up. Now, here's what you do when you're a hurdler. Now, I know they've got 330 highs, and they've got a whole lot of different type of hurdle races now, and I've been out of it so long, I don't keep up with it. But here's, you either three-step in between those hurdles. I think they're about 10 yards apart. Don't know exactly. So somebody online is correcting me right now. That's great. I don't know, man. I'm just saying. However far they are apart. But so you can run a three. You can three-step. You can five-step. And if you three-step or you five-step, then you're leading with the same lead leg and the same. But now if you four step, then you have to learn to alternate your lead leg. I wasn't that smart or I guess coordinated. So I'm going to three or I'm going to five. And three stepping is what you want to do. I mean, if you want to win the race, you got to three step because that gets you there a lot quicker. Five steps, you know, you're kind of chopping a little bit and you're slowing down. It's not a good thing. And so if you're going to win, you got to three step. So I could three step most of the hurdles. But then you get a little tired, you know, you're hurdling down the track, right? And so the last few hurdles, I always had to five-step them. And I was pretty fast. I was out in front almost every race. I would jump out, I'd be ahead of everybody, and I'm three-stepping. Man, I'm three-stepping, I'm getting it, three-stepping. But then all of a sudden, now I got a five-step. And I could hear them catching up. Here they come. All right. I can hear them. And as I would hear them, oftentimes that would be distracting to me. I'd be thinking, oh, goodness, man, I wish my legs were longer, but they're not. And on these last few, I got a five-step. Boy, I wish I could do it. And then I could hear them. Here they come. And sometimes, not every time, but enough times for me to have bad memories, I can remember having to five-step, getting to those last few hurdles, and being so distracted And then I would catch one of those hurdles and I'd roll it up and I'd end up rolling myself up, picking cinder out of my arms and my legs and not finishing the race. You see, the tragedy is distractions can keep you from not finishing the race. You can get distracted. It's so easy to lose focus. I don't know if you notice this. It's so easy to get distracted. You all know the story in 1 Samuel chapter 17. Let me talk a little bit about that. That's the story of David and Goliath. Goliath of Gath. You know the story in the Valley of Elah. David, the shepherd boy, taking those five smooth stones and the slingshot and bringing down the 10-foot Philistine named Goliath. All right, we all know the story. But do you know the part of that story that maybe you haven't thought a lot about? See, David's dad, his name was Jesse, he had 8 sons, and the firstborn was named Eliab. Eliab. And David showed up, and as you know in Scripture, he showed up. He's the youngest son of Jesse. He shows up on the battlefield. His oldest brother, Eliab, wasn't very happy. And in verse 28 of that chapter, notice what he said. He said, "What are you doing here, you punk?" No, not exactly. That's my translation. What he said is, "Why have you come down here?" Which is basically the same thing I said. "What are you doing here?" You know, the little brother. "What are you doing here?" Eliab said, "And with whom did you leave those few sheep in the wilderness?" That's interesting to me because David is a responsible young man. He left those sheep with somebody. He had them taken care of. But here is Eliab. I mean, jerking his chain. David said, "Hey, I got that. I took care of that." But here's the thing. The enemy is trying to distract David, to get him to fight the wrong person. Don't miss this. See, if he stands there and he fights and he argues with his brother, he will never do what he's there to do. Now, somebody needs to hear this. If you're married, I want you to look straight ahead. I'm helping you out here. I'm just trying to be your friend. See, sometimes you're fighting against what you're supposed to be fighting for. Get that? That's a distraction. Sometimes you have to call a timeout. You just got to say, hey, wait a minute. You're not my enemy. Timeout. I know we're fighting here, but this distraction, you're not the one I'm really fighting. Sometimes you just need to say, I'm not supposed to be fighting with you at all. That's not what I'm here. And see, if David gets caught up fighting Eliab, he never sees Goliath. If he gets distracted, he misses the road that leads to Goliath and to victory. Some of us are defeated because we're distracted. Now, you've read this story. You know how it ends, right? You understand. But it could have ended much differently. Let's just imagine David gets distracted and he spends the next 2 hours arguing with his brother and defending himself. Because that's what we tend to do, right? I mean, one of the distractions that the enemy wants to get you in is somebody comes against you and you want to stand toe-to-toe. Yeah, you know, you're a big boy and you just want to stand toe-to-toe and defend yourself. I didn't say that. I didn't do that. You can't say that about me, right? So we get distracted and we're fighting oftentimes the wrong person. But listen, if that would have happened, you would have had a different story. I mean, Sunday school would have been a little different. VBS, you'd have had to kind of change those stories around, right? Some of us never get to Goliath because we get distracted by what somebody said or what they did. And we go to defense mode and we stop running the race. There are people that aren't seated here today that have stopped running the race. Sometimes it's because they've been offended. Sometimes they're just too doggone sensitive about things. I'll just tell you, sometimes believers need to put on some mature big boy pants in Christ and understand just because they didn't shake your hand does not mean they don't love you. They may have had 100 other things on their mind at that point, you see. And so we get offended. We get offended by this and this and that. And they said this and they did that. And so before long, what happens is the enemy has found a way to distract you from your divine destiny, from the mission that God has called you to do. This happens a lot. So let me give you something practical. Because some of you, I believe, are fighting a lion. Maybe nobody in this room, maybe somebody with us online, and Goliath is going unchallenged in your life. And you know you're fighting Goliath if you're still blaming people. I love it. It's hanging on my wall two or three different places. It says, simple minds talk about people. And I think creative minds talk about plans. Wise minds talk about vision. What do you talk about when you're with people? You talk about other people? I mean, is that what you're doing? If you're doing that, then you are being distracted. Because when you're blaming people, what you're doing is putting an external answer to an internal problem that has to be dealt with internally, not externally. But here's the part. Here's the part of the story that we need to hear. David did something we all need to know how to do. This is going to help somebody today. And I want you to read it. It's in verse 30. Here's what he did. He then turned away. Underline that. Circle that. David turned away from Eliab. And he turned to somebody else and brought up the same matter. You see, notice when he turned away from Eliab, it positioned him to face Goliath. And Eliab wasn't the enemy. Listen, he was a potential distraction. David said this, no, I'm not going to go there. Not going to go there. See, you come to church today, maybe for what I'm about to say right now. Can I show you one of the best ways to deal with distractions? This is going to be good. You need this. Don't miss this. This is so deep and theological. And there is some intricate study that backs up this. Are you ready? Here's the way you deal with distractions. No. Some of you missed it. I get it. It was fast. So let me show it. I didn't put it on the screen for you. Sorry about that. So let me give it to you again. One of the best ways you deal with distractions is no. Now, maybe here's what you need to do. You need to tilt your head a little bit like this, or I don't know, maybe this way or that. What works best? You can be ambidextrous in this, left or right-handed, whatever. But maybe you just kind of, no. Do this with a smile on your face, would you please? Do this with kindness in your heart as a Christian believer. Just say no. No, I get it. The whole drug thing, just say no. What I'm telling you is many of the distractions in your life are self-induced because you can't say no. Listen, you got to learn. And I get this, man. Listen, I know what it is. And I could preach another message altogether on how Jesus dealt with this, and maybe someday we'll do that because there's some clear scriptural teaching as we follow our master, the model, Jesus himself. But one of the things that happens in my life, maybe this happens with you, people will come and it just seems like, look, listen, I'm trying to get 2 hours of study here, undistracted study. I pastored some churches where I had multiple offices in the building, and that was on purpose. And secretaries who would be told, dude, I am gone. Please, I know that sister, I've got to pick somebody. Sister Bert, we don't have a Berthelene here, do we? I know Sister Berthelene has an emergency. But I gotta get in the study. I gotta get along with God. I gotta get in His Word. I don't need to be distracted right now. People will come and they'll say, "Hey, preacher, we found these gum wrappers in the parking lot." And I want to go, "Are you serious up in here? I'm in the Word of God. And you want to talk to me about gum wrappers? I mean, I've got a race to run. I have a divine destiny here. And it is to proclaim the truths of the Word of God to God's people and shepherd the flock." And sometimes we get distractions. Sometimes you've got to be able to say no. You know why? Because if you say yes to everything, you're going to be so distracted. You're going to be so strung out. You're never going to be able to stay on track with God. You're just going to be so schizophrenic. You're going to be everywhere. Learn to say no. Now, let me tell you this. There is a point when God tells you to do this, you don't need to say no. Even if you're too busy, because you're never too busy for God to say do this. But there are a lot of other things that I don't believe necessarily God is calling you to do, that sometimes you do, and you do that to the detriment and to the distraction of running the race that he has set before you. So distractions. You say no. Now, I think I went over that enough. And by the way, you don't say no because. I'm just telling you. Because there again, you know. Now we're going to go into great detail and why I'm telling you no. And then let's all be spiritually mature enough to accept the truth that, you know, maybe I don't need an explanation. Do I need an explanation? No, I'm okay with that. Or you don't say, maybe. If it's a no, it's a no, not a maybe. You see, a lot of us, you know, we want to set people down softly, and we think we're being so kind, and so we want to say, well, yeah, maybe, but you don't mean maybe, you mean no. So just say it. No, I love you. I love you, brother. I love you, sister in Jesus, but no, no. I mean, let's practice again. Maybe we need to do this all together. You, one of the greatest ways to defeat a distraction in your life is by saying no. No. Yeah. All right. So you got that. Not maybe, but no. If it's a distraction to your development in Christ, say no. Now notice, the word, David's story could have ended a whole lot different. Let me get back to that. That's good to know. That's good to know because your story, listen, your story is still being written. And it's not over yet. You get that? It's not over yet. It's not over yet. Your story is still being written. And it's not over yet. Are you still breathing? Yeah. You walk into this building this morning? Yeah. Your story's not over yet. And maybe you've wasted some time in your life, and I get that. I can join that party with you. Maybe we've wasted some time along the way. But what if God can redeem the years that the locusts have eaten? What if your best days are not behind you? What if the devil is a liar? What if the devil is a liar? God still has a purpose. What if God still intends to help you finish your race? What if you run with endurance the race that's set before you? I mean, what happens if you focus on Jesus instead of that distraction? Then the author, and you got to get this, the author gives us this greatest motivation to keep running the race, and it's in verse 2, and let's read it again. Looking unto Jesus, who? Looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame. And he has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Now, what did he say? Looking unto Jesus. Looking unto Jesus. Your translation may say, fixing your eyes on Jesus. He's the author. He's the finisher. He endured the cross. He's seated at the right hand of the Father. This is about focus. Heads up. Eyes open. When I coached football and we were teaching a kid to tackle, here's the thing that I would say. I would say, look, all right, you need to break down. You need to get in a good tackling position. I want your eyes to the sky. I want you to put that face mask right in between those numbers. He's wearing number 88. I want to see you just stick him right between those numbers. I want your eyes up, eyes to the sky. You can't hit what you can't see. You guys understand? You can't hit what you can't see. And so your focus is so vitally important. It's so important. Eyes to the sky. Look to Jesus, he said. He is our example. He made it to the finish. He went to a cross. He went to a rugged Roman cross. And his arms were spread wide. And his feet were nailed to the cross. And his arms were nailed to the crossbeams of the cross. He died in nakedness and shame. Died a death he did not deserve. He was the perfect Lamb of God, sinless. Yet he went to a cross. And what did he do? He finished is missing. As a matter of fact, he said, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, when he was on the cross. Lord, it's done. Father, why have you forsaken me? And he couldn't look at the sin because it was your sin and it was my sin. And Jesus carried it. He could have called 10,000 angels, but he didn't. I mean, just with a wink or a snap, he could have got down off that cross. But he didn't. Why? But he didn't because he was finishing what he started. And so what the author is saying to us is, you can make it. How can you make it? You have this example. Jesus made it, and he made it for you so that you can finish. You see, one of the most underappreciated attributes of Jesus, in my mind, is his sense of focus. Have you thought about that? Jesus was focused on his mission, determined. And people were always trying to get him off his mission, right? And not just the Jews, but even his own buddies, even his own disciples were trying to distract him. I don't know if you've seen the bumper sticker, God loves you and everyone else has a wonderful plan for your life. God loves you and everybody else has got it figured out for you. Don't get distracted. You know why? Because God's got a plan for your life. You have a great destiny. But you can't forget Matthew 13. It says that we have a great enemy too. And your enemy loves to catch you sleeping. And he comes along and he plants those seeds of distraction in your life. Your enemy can't take away your destiny. He can only plant distractions next to it to keep you from recognizing it. So whatever your distraction is, I don't know if I've said this yet, but Jesus is greater than your distraction. Jesus said the greatest commandment of this is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. You remember that? All your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. Not with a distracted heart. Not with a divided heart. Not with I'm sometimes in, I'm sometimes out. Not with a non-committal, indecisive heart. Jesus wants to bring you back to focus so you can run well, so you can finish well, so you can complete the mission that he gave you. Now, I'm going to take a little liberty here. Because, see, not only does this happen individually, not only is the devil tremendously conscious of every believer and the fact that he can't destroy you, but he can distract you. But this happens in churches. I've seen it. You guys know my story. I'm a PK, and I was born in a parsonage. And I've seen so many churches and bodies of believers where they become distracted. Can I tell you something this morning? One of the greatest tragedies in any church is for a church to lose the focus of why we're here. That's tragic. And then so what happens is we become this entertainment center. Man, go to Branson for that. Or we become this coddling country club. Because, we've got some people that really know how to give, and they really give, but then they want to always tack something to them. Not always, but some want to, and so we have to coddle to them. I'm speaking with a pastor friend. It was been a little while ago, and he was so discouraged, and he said things that I think I've said back in the day, and I don't say them anymore. I'll just be honest with you. He was saying, I got three kids at home, and that one deacon is a knothead, and he's just doing this and this and this, and man, he's just distracting us and doing this and trying to do this and behind my back doing this and talking about me and all this stuff. And I said, bro, I get it. That's tough. That's hard. He said, yeah, and I know I need to confront him biblically. I know I need to do that. But what if they send me down the road and I don't get paid anymore? What happens to my kids that need to eat? How do I pay my bills? Now, I get it. Now, some of you are already being way too judgmental, so you need to back that bus up. And you need to think, okay, because a lot of you think the same way. And so just because he's a man of God, called of God, pastor in a church, doesn't mean that he's not thinking about those things. But now he's in this tension between, well, I got to coddle that dude. Even though he is so far out in the left field, jacking with everything, I got to coddle him because I like to make sure my kids get fed. That's such a tragedy, isn't it? That we see that in the body of Christ. We see that type of activity in the body of Christ, and yet he goes on. So sometimes we're distracted, and we're distracted away from the mission that God has given us. So now we got to maintain that particular group or organization in the church just because that person who is the leader of that group has been doing it for 50 years. Nobody's come. Nobody's getting blessed. It's diverting all kinds of things away from what we ought to be doing, but I'm not going to mess with it. No. You see what I'm talking about? It happens in the church. We get distracted. We get distracted. Or we come in here on Sunday morning and it's all about preacher. Man, if you didn't ring the bell for me today, then just didn't get it. Our worship happens and these songs of praise that we have an opportunity to bring before a holy God, we kind of miss out on that because, it's not quite what we like, or this didn't do that, or we're so focused away from what our mission is. This is exactly what happens in the life of an individual and in the life of a church if you don't stay focused. Stay focused. Okay, so preacher, that all sounds good. So what is the main thing that should be kept the main thing? Well, he told us, it's not hard. Go into all the world and preach, teach, and baptize. Make disciples of all nations. Do that in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And then he said, hey, I'm with you. Lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. I'm going to be with you. So we've got to see people come to know Christ, right? What are you thinking about today? You're thinking about somebody that needs to know Jesus? Are you thinking that in just a few moments we're going to extend an invitation? We're going to invite people and we're going to share with them how they can come to know Christ. Are you thinking today, who is it that needs to come to know Christ? Maybe it's me. Or maybe it's somebody next to me or somebody. Maybe it's my neighbor that I didn't even invite today. Maybe it's somebody else that I'm witnessing to, and I want to see them come to know Christ. That's the main thing. And we got to keep the main thing, right? Because, listen, we can be so easily distracted. Paul said it this, I can't do anything about the past. All those distractions of the past, but I can press on. I can press on to the goal, to the win, the prize for which God has called me heavenward. I have a destiny. Do you? Yeah, you do. And I refuse to let distractions sidetrack me. How about you? Hey, listen, the clock's ticking. Time is of the essence. There is an urgency to this hour. And so let's not get distracted. Let's not get distracted. I've pastored churches where we've built buildings and some of this, and sometimes people get distracted. It becomes about the building. I've pastored churches in places and been involved in ministries that they get distracted. Let's not get distracted. We have a race to run. We have a race to run. We run it with endurance. We run it with perseverance. And by the way, can I tell you, this is not an easy thing to do. If you think you signed up for a cakewalk, you didn't. Jesus said, come and follow me. But what did he say? Take up your cross. Now, wait a minute, Jesus. You're talking about that instrument of death? Are you talking about that cruel instrument of death that the Romans had perfected? Are you talking about that bloody, stained cross?
Yeah. That's the one. He said, take it up and come and follow me. Yeah, preacher, though, it's hard. Man, I'm not minimizing the hardness. And I'm not saying to you that this is an easy thing. Far too many churches are preaching that message. And so I don't want to get on that bandwagon with them because I think they're missing some things. Oh, just come to Jesus and, you know, you'll be fine. If you're bald-headed, you'll have hair. Just come to Jesus. If your wife can't cook, she'll be able to. You come to Jesus, you know. Come to Jesus and, you know, that transmission that's out of your truck, and you'll just walk out. You come to, it'll be all, whoa, transmission. Come to Jesus. Listen, come to a cross. Pick it up and persevere and endure in the hard times. Endure. We all got our stuff. And it's not all pretty. Sometimes it's hard. But it says keep running. Keep running this race with perseverance, with endurance. Why? Because you've got this cloud of witnesses that are an example to you that you can complete what he has started. The Bible says Jesus will complete the work that he has begun in you. And he'll do it. How do you know he'll do it? He's a finisher. Hey, listen, what does it say? He despised the shame. He with shame, he went to a cross. Dying for sins he didn't commit. He's a finisher. Oh, you can't preach the cross without preaching 3 days later. Because 3 days later, he came out of a tomb alive. Yeah, he went to the cross. He finished. He came out of the tomb, resurrected to life by the power of God. He's a finisher. And he says, you can too. You can too. You can finish. And what I love about this passage, and by the way, Paul gives us an insight. Paul talks about, listen, I've got a destiny. Man, the great eagle of evangelism. I refuse to be sidetracked. Now, why is that? Because Jesus is greater than your distractions.
Grateful that you joined us in worship today.
Bless you for being with us here at Northwest Church Online.
Yes, northwestchurch.church. If you would like to hear more content, more messages, biblically based messages, worship experiences, you're welcome to go. And we would love to see you there. Like, share, and subscribe.
Amen. Worship the Lord with us online anytime. We're online.